Welcome back. Today we're talking about five teams we've identified that could make a surprise wild card appearance in the 2018 season. Make sure to go to our website, profootballfocus.com, and check it out. Great article up on it right now, written by Gordon McGinnis. But we're going to discuss our thoughts on it. Gordon gave his, we're going to give our take, and start off with the first team on the list, the Chicago Bears. Added Allen Robinson at wide receiver over the offseason. Added Kevin White, not added, but Kevin White should be back, could actually be healthy for once. Added the great Roquan Smith in the draft there in the top 10. This is a team that's revamped on both sides of the ball, but it's a tough NFC North. So what do you think of the Bears' chances of actually sneaking into the playoffs this year?
It is. And, of course, new coaching staff. Matt Nagy comes in, brings that Kansas City, that Andy Reid coaching tree style of offense, which has taken the league by storm the last couple of years. Doug Peterson in Philadelphia as well. The big thing they're going to do is bring that RPO kind of game to Mitch Trubisky and help him develop as a quarterback, simplify what they're asking him to do, make his life easier with those additions that we're talking about in the offense, bringing in guys like Allen Robinson from the Jaguars. It's a couple of years now since we've seen Allen Robinson's best game, but back in 2015, he was this incredible deep threat who was able to make Blake Bortles look good. In college, he was able to make Christian Hackenberg look good. This guy should be able to be a big addition for this offense. Back in 2015, he led the league in both deep receptions with 19 and deep receiving yards with 672. You add him to that offense, Taylor Gabriel coming in, who's more of a short screen guy. And then, of course, the X factor that is Kevin White, whose career is still less than 300 snaps old because of injuries. There's a lot of talent all of a sudden in that receiving core that just wasn't there before.
Well, and second round pick Anthony Miller out of Memphis, who is as dynamic as we saw after the catch in this draft class. He's probably going to fill the slot. White and Robinson on the outside. That guy's sort of the limit for that wide receiving core, but at the same time, you just don't know with a lot of those guys. There's no real sure thing in that receiving core, and you really are just banking on the Matt Nagy effect. And it was the Sean McVay effect, and it was the Doug Peterson effect out in Philly. The fact that you go from a John Fox offense to, you know, it is a big upgrade in terms of schematically, but is it going to actually take Mitch Trubisky to that next level? Because if it doesn't, that's what you're banking on here with saying the Bears could make the playoffs, because that offense needs to be humming. Because I'm not sure, while the defense is solid, I'm not sure it's an elite enough defense to carry an average offense to the playoffs.
Yeah, and I think it will. It's going to see a big upgrade both from Trubisky and from that offense overall. Even last season, we saw towards the end of the year, once they took the training wheels off and they started to let Trubisky actually play quarterback rather than just play game manager, we saw a better player. And this is going to be a system that's dramatically easier for him to operate in. I think that offense will be better, and it's going to need to be, because like you said, the NFC North is going to be tough. The NFC generally is going to be really tough to fight for wild cards. I think the Bears will be in the mix, but that's going to be a pretty brutal gauntlet to run.
Two things I'm interested in seeing with this offense. One is, do they use Mitch Trubisky and his running threat? Because he is a fantastic athlete. He could actually be a threat as an option sort of quarterback, as a runner. And two, do they bring it more into that offense? Because we saw how last year Kansas City made Alex Smith into the most productive deep passer in the NFL. Mitch Trubisky, when he did go deep, was very productive, but they just didn't do it much last year in the Bears' offense. Was that a factor of Mitch Trubisky just being scared to go deep, or was it a factor of just that offense was not planned around the deep ball? So those are the two biggest things I want to see. If they utilize this run threat and they go deep a lot, I think they could feasibly sneak back into the playoffs. On to the next team on the list, though, Houston Texans, and this one really comes down to injuries. Deshaun Watson, J.J. Watt, if those two guys are healthy, back to their best, yes, they could even win the AFC South, but huge injury concerns there for both.
Yeah, Watt in particular, we just don't know what he is anymore. He was still fantastic last year in the limited snaps he played before getting injured, but it was a very significant knee injury.
Yes.
Again, it's another significant injury for Watt, taking him out of the game. At his best, he may be the best player in all of football. He is a phenomenal interior player, a phenomenal edge rusher. He's a guy that can play anywhere on that defensive line, generate pressure, get into the backfield, stuff the run as well. But it's now been so long since they've been able to count on him on any kind of long-term basis. He has the potential to dramatically upgrade that defense all by himself, but we just don't know what he's able to bring. The thing that I'm interested in is, not just can Deshaun Watson stay healthy all year long with still what looks like a pretty ugly offensive line on paper, but two, what are we going to see in terms of his numbers coming back down to earth? Because he had some absolutely incredible statistics last season, and the grading didn't quite match. And when that happens, the difference between the grading, when we go through watch and grade every single play, and the raw statistics he's showing, that tends to flag that as a potential regression down the line. You know, you tend to stick closer to your grading than you do those outlier numbers. So are we going to see Deshaun Watson kind of come back down to earth a little bit, or will he still be able to do some of the crazy things he was doing last year?
I think the biggest thing with that is, you kind of touched on it briefly, is the fact that he's playing behind the worst offensive line in the NFL. And I don't even think it's a debate at this point. After they traded away Dwayne Brown, that offensive line was awful. Now they've made some revamps to it. They've brought in some players, but no real quality starters whatsoever to speak of. And their third rounder, Martinez Rankins, was a project, in our opinion, coming out as well. So I don't think he's stepping in and being an upgrade right away. At that point, I don't care how good you are. I don't care how developed you are. If you're a young quarterback playing behind an offensive line that bad, I just don't think you're going to be able to have a sustainable success in the NFL, especially coming off an ACL injury. So that, to me, is the most worrisome part of the Texans, of picking them to be a sort of playoff team. Just, I don't know if that's week in and week out that offense is going to be able to be consistent.
Yeah, that offensive line a year ago surrendered 250-plus total pressures. Bad teams allow 200.
Yeah.
So you're adding 50 total pressures over the season to an already bad offensive line. Like you said, they brought in bodies. There are a lot of new faces on that offensive line, but there's nobody that represents an obvious and clear upgrade. The good news is, though, that it did look dramatically different when Watson was out there versus Tom Savage. The way they changed that offense to mold around what Watson does well did make the offensive line look better. Even if it wasn't any better, it simplified what they were asking them to do. It didn't put as much pressure on them. So in theory, it should look better this year just with Watson out there. But it's obviously a two-way sword. It's still going to work against them.
Yeah, and then on the other side of the ball, worrisome the fact that their secondary took such a huge step back after they lost that pass rush up front. Kevin Johnson, one of the higher-graded corners in 2016, was one of the lowest-graded corners in the NFL in 2017. The former first-round pick, he has to get back to that form because they don't have a ton of answers there on the back end. Even bringing in Tyrann Mathieu, it's still a fairly weak secondary just on paper at this point. So you're basically banking on Deshaun Watson carrying this team if you're going to be able to make the playoffs there. On to the next team, another one in the AFC, and a team that knows a thing or two about bad offensive lines, the Miami Dolphins. But they tried to address it. They brought in Josh Sitton this offseason, one of the best pass-protecting guards in the NFL. He'll for sure be an upgrade there. Team up on the left side with Laremy Tunsil. Could actually be an okay offensive line for the first time in a while in Miami. And then you get Ryan Tannehill back and healthy behind it. So with those two pieces in place, they could actually have a good offense for once in a while.
I think the offense could look okay. You've got Josh Sitton. He allowed just 18 total pressures over the last two seasons. Admittedly, time missed in both years. So it's not a full slate of games for both those seasons. But I think he still is the best pass-protecting guard in the NFL. It should be a dramatic upgrade for that offensive line that has struggled with pass blocking across the board. Laremy Tunsil, I think, could still prove to be a pretty good left tackle if you help him out, particularly with Josh Sitton coming in inside. Albert Wilson came over to replace what they lost in Jarvis Landry, or at least be part of replacing that. The running backs, I actually am a big fan of. Kenyon Drake already there. Now they've drafted
Kalen Ballage
in the draft. So that backfield, I think, looks pretty exciting. Ryan Tannehill was always a pretty good quarterback, albeit a guy who maybe has a low enough ceiling, but I think his floor is pretty high as well. You more or less know what you're going to get from Tannehill. Suddenly that offense, I think, could be pretty capable, and it's a case of what you're going to get from the defense.
Yeah, the biggest thing with them is we love their draft class. Like we think those guys, Mike Gesicki, Minkah Fitzpatrick, could be guys who make an impact, you know, even Jerome Baker, linebacker, year one in terms of what they can do. And if that is the case, I could see them sneaking in, especially in an AFC East where you got the Bills and the Jets who just on paper look like they're not going to be close to 500 at this point. You have a fairly weak schedule there in the AFC East.
The Bills dramatically overachieved last season. Yeah. I mean, I think they were surprised by how well they managed to do last year. I think this season we're probably going to see them take a step back significantly. The Jets obviously are still going to be rebuilding with a young quarterback in the fold. At least in the division, it's there for the Dolphins to take. The question is, do they have the quality to do it? I agree that the draft class was really good. It was very athletic. It's one of the most, that was the theme for that draft to me, is every one of those guys was a dramatic athletic upgrade from the guy they're going to be coming in replacing. And from that standpoint, they could all have early impacts. And if that happens, there is a path for that team to get into the playoffs.
The worrisome thing, though, for me for the Dolphins, defensive line have been their strength for years. Now, all of a sudden, Cameron Wake's 36 years old. Not sure how long he's going to be able to still do it. They cut Ndamukong Suh over the course of the offseason. He had a 90.9 overall grade. He carried the interior of that defensive line. And all they brought in was Robert Quinn, who there was a reason why the Rams got rid of him. He had not been productive, you know, in years now. It just injuries have taken its toll on his efficiency. So D-line could be an issue, not going to be have the same teeth, and then it's not a secondary that's strong enough to carry themselves on their own without a good D-line in front of them.
Yeah, Robert Quinn coming off an overall 58.1 PFF grade, and his grade, if you look at the player grades on part of your PFF subscription, his grade has gone down from a 99 back in 2013. It's gone down every single year since that amazing season. This is a guy that does not look to have the burst and the pass rushing ability that he once had. I just don't see the upgrade there.
Yeah, that defense still a pretty big concern. So they could sneak in on the front on the backs of that offense, but some question marks on D. On to the next team, Washington Redskins in a tough NFC East, but a lot of reasons why that offense could carry them to the playoffs.
Yeah, I think this is I think this is a team that definitely has the ability to get in. But again, we talked about the NFC being such a tough place to be. I think there's just so many teams that are going to be vying for those wild card spots. But you bring in Alex Smith. Okay, you lost Kirk Cousins in the offseason, but they were clearly never wedded to Kirk Cousins as a long-term option. Alex Smith comes in off the back of the best season of his career. The question is going to be, can you replicate that outside of that offense that we saw in Kansas City that did lead the league in terms of RPO percentage, run pass options, along with the Philadelphia Eagles? It's going to be a different offense now for Alex Smith in Washington. Will you still get the aggressive Alex Smith that we saw last year, the guy that's prepared to put the ball in the air when he sees his receivers one-on-one, or is he going to go back to that pathologically conservative player we saw basically for the rest of his career?
Yeah, and the interesting thing, though, here is the Redskins actually probably have a better offensive line in front of him than he had in Kansas City. This, when healthy, could be one of the best offensive lines in the NFL. They just suffered so many injuries a season ago that they just had so many combinations up front that it just wasn't working. One of the reasons why Cousins took a step back. But Alex Smith has some fairly similar weapons to what he had in Kansas City in terms of if they are healthy, though. Jordan Reed, an incredibly dynamic tight end when he's on the field, one of the best after-the-catch threats. And then Josh Doctson sort of started to come on towards the end of last season. We were super high on him coming out. So there's weapons to be had there, along with second-round pick Darius Geis at running back. There's weapons to be had on offense. It just remains to be seen how it's all going to mesh together there.
There is no Tyreek Hill, though.
Which that is fair.
Which
that
is a problem.
Fair. And that is a bit, Paul Richardson, not the Tyreek Hill impersonator, but has some deep speed, at least a deep threat into that offense.
He does. He's a guy that I think always seems like he should be better than he actually is. He's got the speed. He's got the athleticism. He has highlight reel catches. Some of his top-end plays are spectacular, but he just doesn't do it all consistently. He's a guy that gets thrown an incredible amount of contested catches, but doesn't come down with that many. His contested catch rate in terms of the number of targets sent his way that were actually contested balls was extremely high last year, but the rate in which he brought them in was extremely low. So he's a guy, again, his calling card is that he's able to go and win those contested catches, but it just doesn't seem to actually be the case statistically.
Yeah, Washington, though, going to have a tough path to the playoffs with the Eagles in that division, with the Cowboys in that division, and the Giants also should be better at least than they were last year. So it's going to take a lot for them to get in. Last team on the list here, Los Angeles Chargers. If you go and watch, we already had a video where I called them the Super Bowl favorites in the AFC, so calling them a wild card surprise is crazy. Gordon, terrible take there. But why would we be surprised if they didn't make a wild card here, Sam?
Yeah, if they're not going to get the wild card spot, it's because they're going to take the division, right?
Yeah.
The Raiders, I don't think, are going to be anything this year. That team does not look like it's heading in the right direction. Denver are still going to be struggling, I think, to get back to where they were so good. They still don't really have a surefire answer at quarterback. Case Keenum is there coming off a career year, but is he going to be able to elevate the rest of that team? Which really leaves the Chargers and then the Kansas City Chiefs with Patrick Mahomes at quarterback, who is something of an unknown quantity. I think all of us, like Patrick Mahomes, think he's going to be a good player, but we're dealing with 62 snaps of NFL action plus his preseason. We just don't know if he's going to be able to do it for the long haul and take that team all the way to the top of the division, at which point it really does look like the Chargers to lose.
Yeah, the AFC West at one point a season ago looked like it was going to be the best division in football. This year heading in, you'd be surprised if, you know, more than one team ends up above 500. It's just a lot of those teams took a lot of hits over the course of the offseason, and the Chargers are sort of like last man standing at this point. They were a better team than the 9-7 they were a season ago. Only, I think, have gotten better over the course of the offseason with guys returning from injury. Now, they lost Hunter Henry already, which sucks, and it's pretty much the MO for the Chargers, losing critical players in the offseason. But the high-level talent that the Chargers have is as good as any team in the NFL, to be honest. And so if they don't win the AFC East, I would be very surprised.
And they're good in the right areas as well. They've got phenomenal pass rush. Bosa and Ingram, probably the best duo in the NFL, led the league in terms of total pressures from a pass rush duo last year with 151 total pressures. They're also strong in the secondary. They've got quality corners. They've got guys like Desmond King. They've got Jason Verrett perennially coming back from injury, but when he's on the field, is fantastic. And of course, Casey Hayward, who last season was the best graded corner in the entire year. Not just the best graded corner in 2017, but that was the second highest number we've seen after that Darrell Revis 2009 year.
Good year.
Phenomenal. So they're strong where you should be strong. Really for them, it's going to be, are you going to have another one of those injury nightmares where just key guys just keep getting knocked down?
Yeah, that really is, because they don't have a ton of depth, but they, like you said, they're strong at the correct positions. Pass rusher, cornerback, wide receiver, and they got a quarterback. A little bit of a quarterback in Phillip Rivers. So there you have it. Those are the five teams that we think could surprise to make wild card appearances this coming season. Make sure to tune into the Pro Football Focus YouTube channel for all of your NFL needs.